Greetings in the name of Yahwah HaMashiach. At the end of today's broadcast, I'll have a mailing address, phone number, and website. Please stay tuned.
Greetings in the name of Yahwah, the only name given among men, whereby we must be saved. And we do appreciate each and every one of you who has taken your time to tune in this program. And we believe it'll be a real blessing. We're going to be turning back over to the book of Romans. Matter of fact, we pretty much ended in the 16th verse of the book of Romans, the 10th chapter and the 16th verse. And we're going to pick this back up again. And we want to, what we're looking at, matter of fact, when you look at the book of Romans here, the writer, who was Apostle Paul, is referring back to Scripture. Or let's say it this way, back to the Old Testament. What a lot of people understands it as. And Apostle Paul is writing and basing what he's writing here on Scripture. What belongs to the Old Testament. And in this, and in these writings that Paul is quoting from, he is using Scripture that would be using the name of the Creator of heaven and earth. And that alone ought to make you think that the writer of a New Testament is going back to the Scripture to where the name of the Creator of heaven and earth is being used. And the reason why I'm saying this is because of the teaching that's being taught. The teaching that's being taught today is a teaching that nobody knows his name, or nobody can write his name. Nobody can say his name, or it's just totally been forgotten. Now, just in the natural, you would think, how could anybody forget the Creator of heaven and earth, his name? Well, you know, the Bible says they had forgotten his name for Baal. And a lot of times, that forgotten doesn't mean that they just didn't know it no more, as much as they forgotten it for Baal. In other words, they just started using Baal. And Israel did this, and they went into Balaam worship. They got in trouble by doing this. So the purpose of, we'd been reading the book of Hebrews several weeks ago, before we come over here to the book of Romans, the 10th chapter, and we find that the writer, ever who it was, in the book of Hebrews acknowledged the tabernacle. That's in the ninth chapter of the book of Hebrews, and understood the service that was in it, the operation of it. And this, and ever who the writer was of the book of Hebrews, was referring back to the tabernacle. In other words, just say it this way, the tabernacle of Moses. And its order, how it was set up, and how the operation of the priesthood. Because if you go back over to the Old Testament scripture, to where this is referred to, you're not going to find any other name used in the tabernacle among the priesthood, the operation of it being used, any other name other than the name of Yahwah. You're not going to find it. But ever who the writer is in the book of Hebrews, in the ninth chapter, he's referring back to the Old Testament tabernacle in the Old Testament. And if you would go back over and look at the tabernacle, look at the order of it, look at the service of it, look at the priesthood, look at the sacrifices, and you would see that there was only one name, and it was the name of Yahwah. And you can do it. You can take your King James Bible. You can take any translation that you want to and go back over there. Of course, a lot of translations are going to use the word Lord, L-O-R-D in capital letters, God, G-O-D in capital letters, and also the word Jehovah, used 7 times. And this is how the King James Bible does it. And you can study this for yourself. Then when we have went back over to the book of Romans in the 10th chapter, and we're finding Apostle Paul, who is the writer of the book of Romans here, he's acknowledging scripture that uses the name of Yahwah. And this is all the way through the King James Bible. You remember one thing. When you go to the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, at the time when the Messiah walked on the face of this earth, you did not have none of these books written. They would be written later. That means that everything that the Messiah done, he had to go to the scripture. Matter of fact, in the book of St. John, 5:39, the Messiah said, "Search the scriptures, for in them ye think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me, talking about the Mashiach. The Kitvei HaKodesh, known as the Holy Scriptures. Then the Messiah said in St. John 5:43, a few verses after that, he said, I come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. But if another come in his own name, him would you receive, or you would believe. Now, when you look at this and you examine this from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, can give no record for the book of Acts other than once the Messiah had shed his blood and 50 days after the resurrection of the true Mashiach, you would have Pentecost. Other than that, you have no book of Acts even written. When the Messiah walked on the face of this earth, before he shed his blood, he was still living in the Messiah himself, under an Old Testament covenant. Even though he was without sin, he was still born in what you would call the Old Testament. He lived in it till he shed his blood. Then, by the shedding of his blood, is what brought in the New Testament, the Dam Berit HaKadoshah. Now, so when you look at the four Gospels, they call them, a lot of times the way people teach is that you would think that the Messiah was reading out of the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which is not so. But Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is basing everything they have strictly on from Genesis to Malachi, because there was no writing of a New Testament period. Where when you come into or after the Holy Spirit was poured out on the day of Pentecost, and then later on as the epistles begin to be written, and as those epistles begin to be written, then the epistles themselves are based on Scripture from Genesis to Malachi. That's like the first plan of salvation that was ever given to the early assembly nearly 2,000 years ago. Apostle Peter, who had the keys to the kingdom. On the day of Pentecost, they had no writing of any book or books. That means they didn't have the writings of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John until after the Holy Spirit was poured out on the day of Pentecost. Then, several years later, they would start writing the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They would start writing, later on, the epistles and the book of Acts. But it took time. So Apostle Peter, on the day of Pentecost, gave the very first plan of salvation. The very first plan of salvation using the book of Joel to 32. Now, once you can understand this, that when Apostle Peter, who had the keys to the kingdom, give the plan of salvation, using only one name, quoting from Joel 2:32. In matter of fact, he only quoted part of it. He quoted the part of salvation of the book of Joel. So once you begin to look at all this and understand this, then this is why the writers, and even Apostle Paul, told Timothy about the scriptures. He said, the scriptures are able to make thee wise unto salvation. Now, this is what Apostle Paul said. Now, what we have to do, we have to get back to understand what the Bible actually says. And that's why when you go through any place in the book of Matthew, the book of Mark, the book of Luke, the book of John, the book of Acts, the book of Romans, Corinthians, any of them that uses the word scripture or scriptures, it's referring strictly from Genesis to Malachi. And the reason why is because this New Testament that we have was based with a foundation of what the prophets had given witness to. The best way I can describe it is this. The Old Testament, what actually is in Hebrew known as Dam Berit, which means blood covenant. In the scriptures of the Old Testament, or the Dam Berit, when you go over there and you look at that, they are actually, or the prophecies are actually, the New Testament concealed. And the New Testament is really the Old Testament revealed, or the New Testament being revealed that was concealed in the Old Testament. And that's why he told, Apostle Paul told Timothy, in 2 Timothy 3:15, he told Timothy, he said, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures. It's a Hebrew word called Kitvei HaKodesh, means holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in the Messiah Yahweh. Now, once you can understand this, then why is it today that we wind up with a name that's pushing it to be 300 years old? Not even quite 250 years old. And that the name of Jesus was never even in the original 1611 King James Bible. And then when you backtrack it, it goes back to the Greek. Then the Greek has a different name than what was in the original 1611 King James Bible. Much less what was in the 1769 edition, known as the Red Letter Edition, that we read out of, study out of. Then something ought to be shaking you within. There ought to be something that's stirring you up within to want to know the truth. People would say, throw up red flags. Well, the Holy Spirit in you should be quickening you to know the truth. Not some of the truth, but know the truth. Because the truth will make you free. And as I've said many, many times, this has nothing to do with attacking your salvation. Attacking your experience. Because maybe this is all you ever known. But now you're hearing the truth. You're hearing the real, true plan of salvation. I come through the same salvation that every one of you have come through. When I run up on this in the 80s, and I begin to study, and I begin to search this out, it wasn't like it is today. You had all these ways of searching and studying, and you had the internet and all this. At that time, you had to dig and search on this. But today, it's really made easy. But you still got to search. You got to hunger for truth. I had an experience with Yahwah. I had the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says the Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. It won't lead you into some of it. It'll lead you into all of it. Yahweh Almighty has an assembly that He's bringing together in all truth. These denominations, organizations, they don't want truth. You can't force a truth in them. The only way you're going to get truth in them, you're going to have to leave. You're not going to stick truth in these denominations that don't want it. They don't want it. It's a man-made setup. This is why you have all these denominations. You have one believes salvation one way, another believes it another way. You have one believes the end time one way, and another believes in another way. And this is on everything. If you preach one doctrine, you got at least two more that's different, if not more. So, the truth will make you free, is what it will do. So, in the book of Romans here, in the 10th chapter, in the 16th verse, I'm going to read this again, and we're just going to continue on. And it says, "But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith," And I'm reading how the King James says, Lord, who have believed our report. Now we know that this here was quoted from the book of Isaiah 53:1. Now, in verse 17, in Romans 10:17, it says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Now, this here where it says, by the word of God, is not talking about the book of Romans. Apostle Paul wasn't saying that faith cometh by hearing the book of Romans. Paul is laying out scripture. If you would back up and follow Romans 10:1 all the way down to verse 17, you'll understand how Paul always keeps going back to the scripture, back to the Old Testament. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, because that's what Apostle Paul's doing. He's going back, as the King James would say, the word of God, and referring back as the word of God being from Genesis to Malachi. In verse 18 of the book of Romans, but I say, have they not all heard? Who's he talking about? He's talking about those that was in the scripture. Yes, verily, their sound went into all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the world. Now, once you begin to examine all this, search this out, I said, search this out. Because if you will examine this, you're going to be understanding that Apostle Paul keeps going back to the scripture. Is what he does. He continues going back to the scripture. He keeps referring back to the scripture. And the truth is the only thing that will make you free. He's using quotations of scripture is really what he's doing. You know, we've been studying and understanding that the writers of the New Testament in their day, in their time, when they were writing the epistles and the doctrines and the salvation that was brought into through the blood of Mashiach that started a testament. Blood is what starts a testament. All of this was already given witness to by the prophets from Genesis to Malachi. So the foundation of the writing of the New Testament has a foundation, and it's scripture. Scripture in Hebrew is known as Kitvei HaKodesh, according to how it's used in where it's used. But at the same time, the gospel that is preached today should be the same gospel that was preached nearly 2,000 years ago. And the gospel that was preached on the day of Pentecost. And when the Messiah come preaching the gospel, he bared witness of everything from Genesis to Malachi. So, In the book of Romans 10:17, it says, "So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." Now, it's a Hebrew word called bidvar Elohim. The word bidvar is the word for word, meaning like in or by the word of Elohim. The word Elohim is usually translated into the King James Bible as the word God. Of course, then you have different ways that the word Elohim is broken down when it goes to the Old Testament, such as like El or Elohai. This is Gordon. But it's all talking about one true God, if you want to say it the way the King James says. When you look at the term G-O-D, and you look at the word, when you see the word God, and it's talking about the God of Israel, or the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, it's only talking about the one true creator of heaven and earth. Now, we understand that there's places in the Old Testament, also New Testament, that talks about gods, and it's not even talking about the creator. It's talking about paganism, pagan gods, where paganism is at. But when you understand, when you read and understand where the word God is being used dealing with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that's a total different picture. And most people will quote, like in the book of Genesis, where it says, "In the beginning, God created." Not even understanding because of the way people are taught today that God, who is the God? See, a lot happened at 325 A.D., at the time of 325 A.D., when they changed baptism from Father or to Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But they changed it from something. Once that got changed, it changed the whole picture of everything. You have a one, if you say it this way, as the King James says, one God message turned into a three God message. In other words, Deuteronomy 6:4. Where it talks about, "Hear, O Israel, that the Lord," King James says, "Lord, our God is one Lord." Now you look up the word Lord and you're going to find that it's in all capital letters. And most people that preaches a oneness message usually refers back to Deuteronomy 6:4. And when they teach Deuteronomy 6:4, they're teaching it to explain their oneness message. But their oneness message today, the day and hour we're living in, doesn't line up to Deuteronomy 6:4. And one reason is because they're without a name for God. And it's And the reason why is because we have today Jesus, J-E-S-U-S. So you have Jesus in the New Testament, but when you go to the Old, you don't find Jesus. Matter of fact, when you go to the Old, if you hear people, you don't even find a name for God, period. But you really would, because the closest that you could find for a name for God would be Jehovah. That's the closest. Now, and then you have to understand why Jehovah was brought in. If you look at your King James Bible, your King James Bible was translated really in a good way, showing a oneness of the Creator of heaven, showing a oneness of God. Producing all that it could to produce one true God with a name. And you find this because you find the word Lord, capital letters, God, capital letters, and then we're back to the word Jehovah again, used seven times. And all of these are cover up, even Jehovah. But Jehovah is closer to being a name than word God. And the word Lord. Remember, the word Lord and God in capital letters is a cover-up, just like Jehovah. If you take the word Jehovah, Lord in capital letters, God in capital letters, this is all caps now, you would have the name of Yahwah. And you still have it from where the King James Bible, the original 1611 King James Bible, was translated from. And also the 1769 edition, known as the Red Letter Edition. If you go back to the translation, in the Hebrew, the name is still there to this day. At the time of the writing of the New Testament, these apostles, these prophets of the New Testament, now I'm not confusing the prophets of the New with the prophets of the Old, but the prophets of the New, the evangelists, pastors, and teachers of the New, understood Scripture. They understood Scripture. They understood that the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had a name. So here in Romans 10:17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Again, it could be the word bidvar Elohim, or either just the word devar Elohim. Usually if you got the word devar, it only means word. When you get the word bidvar, it means in or by. But it's still talking about the word. Now, when you deal with the word word, W-O-R-D, what word is it talking about? Apostle Paul's not writing the book of Romans and saying that faith cometh by hearing the book of Romans. He's basing the book of Romans on a foundation. The foundation is from Genesis to Malachi. Now, let me give you an example about something before we go any farther here in the book of Romans, because I would like to get a whole lot farther than what we've been getting, because I've got some other stuff that I'm wanting to get on, and I'm hoping that we're going to get on some other teachings, but we're still going to deal with the name. But over in the book of Acts, if you've ever noticed in the book of Acts, the 10th chapter of the book of Acts, 10:43 in the book of Acts. Now, we understand, and you've read your Bibles enough to understand, that at the 10th chapter of the book of Acts, the Gentiles are getting salvation. In other words, it looks like now the creator of heaven and earth is starting to deal with the Gentiles, according to the 10th chapter of the book of Acts. Now, we understand, too, that on the day of Pentecost, you had Gentiles that were saved, but they were proselyte. That's a different story. Because, first of all, the Gentiles in the book of Acts looks like now Yahweh is starting to deal with them, where at first, according to the book of Luke, that repentance and remission of sins would be preached in his name beginning at Jerusalem, then into all the world. Israel got the message first. The message blown to Israel. When you look at your Bible was written strictly for Israel. Now we understand about Jeroboam and Rehoboam, them splitting up, and 10 tribes goes with Jeroboam, and then the other two tribes, such as like Judah and Levi, or Levitical priesthood, went and they stayed in Jerusalem. And also some of the tribe of Benjamin also did. But once you look at this and understand this, overall, the message blown to Israel. The Gentiles are only going to get it because of the breaking off of branches. When you go to the book of Romans, you understand this. And all this is really a total different message. But you find a man known as Cornelius. Now, he sends for Apostle Peter because an angel appeared to him. Now, Apostle Peter is preaching to them a message of the plan of salvation without really any writing of a New Testament. If you go by the timing of the writing of Apostle Peter and Paul, somewhere within this time frame, Apostle Paul gets converted. So he couldn't go to the writings of Paul, because Paul hadn't really even got, has just got converted, and really hasn't had the time to write his epistles. It's the same way with Apostle Peter. So, here is Apostle Peter. And when you go to the 43rd verse of the book of Acts, it says, "To him gave all the prophets witness." This is a Hebrew word that's called Kol Hanevi'im Me'idim. The word kol means all. The word Hanevi'im means all the prophets. All the prophets. In other words, the Hanevi'im means the prophets. And when you have kol added to it, it means all the prophets. Now, what prophets is it talking about? The prophets that it's talking about is from Genesis to Malachi. You say, well, look at Abraham. Abraham was a prophet. Go over there and see the type and shadows of how the Mashiach was in what Abraham done. You check the prophets out. These prophets here in Acts 10:43, it says to him gave all the prophets witness that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. Just this message alone right here. Just this verse alone with this message that Apostle Peter is referring to. And he's looking at Gentiles going back to the prophets. Remember, Apostle Peter is the same one that the Mashiach, the Messiah, who, maybe this first time you've tuned in this program, you're going to call him Christ. He was given the keys to the kingdom. Now, the keys that he was given to the kingdom, he had a message, but he didn't have no writing of a New Testament. Matter of fact, at that particular time, the Mashiach had not even shed his blood at the time this was talking about in the book of Matthew, I believe 16th chapter. So once you understand this, here's the man that holds the keys to the kingdom. Several years before the Gentiles here gets saved, gets filled with the Holy Spirit, in the book of Acts, the second chapter, and Apostle Peter, without a book of Acts, he gives the first plan of salvation, going back to the prophets again. And then the second time you find him, given to the Gentiles, he's going back to the prophets again. Acts 2, 16 through 21, he goes to the book of Joel. Here, he's referring back to the scripture. He's preaching the same message that was in Joel here in 10:43. Same plan of salvation. Acts 2:38 has a foundation. Understanding that foundation. Again, it says here in Acts 10:43, to him gave all the prophets witness. Run your prophets out. The prophets, it's talking about not one prophet from Genesis to Malachi ever gave witness to Jesus being the name. Never one prophet ever gave witness that Yehoshua, Jesus would be the name. There's not but one name given. You go and check that when you go to the temple worship, we covered this several weeks ago. When the temple was laid out in the beginning, and the writer of the book of Hebrews understands this. But the pattern that Moses had, Yahweh will give him direction. He give him an order of it. Not one sacrifice was ever done with any other name other than the name of Yahweh. Not one sacrifice. No altar, Bezmeach, was ever made when they were calling on the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to call on any other name other than the name of Yahwah. When that Mashiach hung on that tree, that cross, he'd already said, I come in my Father's name. People turn it around and said, well, that means come in authority. Well, then, what people are really saying then, they're saying, well, he's got a name, but he come in another name for authority. That don't even make sense. The name that he come in was the authority, and it was his Father's name. The Bible plainly teaches this. When you check the prophets out, if we was to stop right here, put the brakes on it right here in 1043, stop here, and you was to have to prove that the prophets gave witness to any other name, you're going to have a problem. You're not going to get nowhere because you're not going to find it. Every sacrifice, every order of the priesthood, this was what Israel's communication with Yahweh was, through the prophets and through the tabernacle, through the priesthood. This is how Yahweh communicated with Israel. To him gave all the prophets witness that through his name, whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. Only through one name. No other name. Now, going back over to the book of Romans real quick, to the 10th chapter, in the 17th verse again. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You have to understand, and this is what I have found. When Yahweh Almighty opened up to me to understand the writing of a New Testament before there was a writing of a New Testament. In other words, I look at a writing of a New Testament now, but what would I have done when I would have been in the early assembly after the Holy Spirit was poured out on the book of Acts and they didn't have a writing of a New Testament? They were in a New Testament because of blood, but they were without a writing, far as what you would call epistles. They were never really without a writing because they had it from Genesis to Malachi. And faith, so faith cometh by hearing. Hearing by the word of Yahwah. Or as King James here says, God. People have been so taught against that all they see today is God. G-O-D, as far as they go. May see the word Lord, L-O-R-D. They see Jehovah and never even really mention it. Going back to what I was saying a few minutes ago about Jehovah. Jehovah would be the closest of a name that you would have in your King James Bible. Of course, you have to understand how Jehovah come about. And some of this, it gets a little complicated because you're dealing with Hebrew vowels, what they call these little dots. And the man who was known as Peter Gallotinus, and some may say his name a little different, but this man understood what was really happening when he began to translate. And he seen the word Lord, or really he seen the word Adonai, and he seen the word Elohim. But he understood, but when he seen the name, there was such a tradition that they wouldn't say the name. They would just say something that was not there. What was there was the name. In the book of Romans 10:18, it says, "But I say, have not they all heard? Yes, verily their sound went into all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the world." Now, this is actually a quotation from the book of Psalms 19:4, from where Apostle Paul is writing the book of Romans. In other words, Romans 10:18 here is quoting from the book of Psalms 19:4. Now, we've been through how the book of Romans is based, its foundation is the Old Testament. That's with any of the epistles. Now, in the 19th verse, it says, now I'm reading from a red letter edition, King James Bible. It says, "But I say, did not Israel know? First Moses saith, I will provoke you to, or provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you." Now, if you will go over, as a matter of fact, if you go over to the book of Deuteronomy 32:21, this is where Apostle Paul is quoting or reading, however he's doing it, from the book of Deuteronomy 32:21. I said that's 32:21, where the book of Deuteronomy is, that Apostle Paul is referring to this. Now, matter of fact, in the book of Deuteronomy 32:21, let me read it. It says, "They have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God. They have provoked me to anger with their vanities. And I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people. I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation." Now, here you have Apostle Paul in the book of Romans keeps going back to the Scripture. And when I'm talking about Scripture, I'm talking about the writing of the Old Testament. In verse 20, it says, "Alas," which is actually Isaiah. This is 10:20 of Romans.
is very bold and saith, I have found, or I was found of them that sought me not. I was manifested unto them that not asked not after me. Now, if you go to the quotation where Paul's quoting this from, it's in the book of Isaiah 65:1. And this is what it says. I am sought of them. This is Isaiah 65:1. From where Romans 10:20 was quoted from. Or read from. This is Isaiah 65:1. He says, I am sought of them that asked not for me. I am found of them that sought me not. I said, behold me, behold me unto a nation that was not called by my name. Now this was Isaiah 65:1. Right here in Isaiah 65:1. And Isaiah is actually, this is where Paul is quoting from Isaiah. And here it says, that was not called by my name. Now, what is so sad is that the day and hour we're living in now, the church is totally being taught against the name that Yahweh would call a foolish nation by. In other words, the church today is being taught a name that's less, a little less than 250 years old, which is the name of Jesus. And not one prophet from Genesis to Malachi ever gave witness to it. Now you need to examine this. When it says, was not called by my name, the name that it's talking about here is the name of Yahwah. That's the name it's talking about. All you have to do is read up above, below, and check out all the places that Isaiah and all the prophets gave witness to. Now, going back over to the book of Romans, the 10th chapter, the 20th verse, I'm going to read it again, then I'm going to the next verse. This is talking about Isaiah, but Isaiah is very bold and saith, I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifested unto them that asked not after me. In the book of Romans 10:21, he says, but to Israel he saith, all day long have I stretched forth my hand, or hands, unto a disobedient and gainsaying people. In the book of Isaiah 65:2 says, I've spread out my hands all the day unto a rebellious people, which walketh in a way that was not good, after their own thoughts. Now, if you would really just continue reading this down to about the fifth verse, it would be a blessing to you. Again, Apostle Paul is referring back to the Scripture. Every time, this is with any of the epistles, going back over to the book of Romans 10:21, I want to read it again before I go to the next verse. It says, but to Israel, what you need to do, I challenge anyone out there to go to the Scripture. Check out who Israel's God was by name, and you'll find it. You'll find in the King James Bible a cover-up using the word Lord in capital letters, God in capital letters, and the word Jehovah. And like we said in, the broadcast before, when you look up the word Jehovah, it would be closer than anything as a name, because God's not a name, Elohim's not a name, Adonai's not a name, and Lord's not a name. But the word Jehovah was put in because when it was being translated, a man known as Peter Gallatinus, who sat up under Pope Leo X, through his translation, he understood that the God of heaven had a name. He understood evidently what was happening. So he took certain vowels, put them in it, and this is how it developed in Jehovah. And when you study it out, you'll know that Jehovah was really not a correct translation far as being the name, but it was closer than Jesus. In other words, Peter Gallatinus, some may say his name different, but acknowledged that the God of Israel did have a name, and they used it. The prophets gave witness to it. And he understood that when he began to translate Scripture, the name was there. The name is still there today. The name of Yahwah is still there today. When they begin to translate, when they sing the name, the four letters of the name of Yahwah, they were so programmed that they literally overlooked it because of teachings that they didn't want the Gentiles to learn it, to blaspheme it. But at the same time, they wind up doing what the third commandment told them not to do, to bring it to naught, to make it vain. But that's what they wind up doing. And today, this is how we wind up the name of Jesus. You wind up with Jesus. And all these different names, such as, like again, like the name of Jesus. How did this come about? This is it. They followed traditions. In other words, if you take your King James Bible, and I'm asking you the question now, give me the name of God that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob called on, the name that was given in the third commandment where it says, thou shalt not take his name in vain. And when the Messiah said, I come in my Father's name, such as in Exodus 9:16, where it says that Pharaoh was raised up, that his name would be declared. Romans 9:17 says the same thing. It was quoting from Exodus 9:16. So once you look at this and you examine this and check it out and find out what has actually taken place. I said, what was really taking place? So what you have to do, you have to study. Search this out. Because the church evidently has never been asked this question. You have men today that are teaching that God is many names sitting in Pentecostal churches. This stuff is false teachings. It's lies straight from the pits of hell is what you have. The Bible talks about false anointed ones, in other words. People are going to raise up. And they're going to teach. And they're teaching totally against what the word of Yahwah is saying. It's sad. The majority of every one of you that's listening to me, listening to this broadcast, have no earthly idea what the name of the Creator of heaven and earth is because of tradition. It means nothing to you. I'm not pointing fingers at you because I've been there. But I had to study. Here we are, we're supposed to be in a church, blood bought, blood washed, and don't understand the true Savior's name. And that is sad. That is sad bad. Because when you start reading this, go to the Old Testament. People read the word Lord and read the word God, maybe come across the word Jehovah every now and then. Not one time does it face them. Then all of a sudden they jump over to the New Testament, got Jesus. All through the New Testament, how did it get there? But then when you go back to the original 1611 King James Bible, it stops. It's not there. You have Jesus. Then, when you go back to that, you got Jesus that was in the original Greek. But how did all this take place? How did all this take place? How can you take an assembly by 325 A.D., get them to believe a Trinitarian doctrine, baptizing titles Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Because of the name, because of what, how they attacked the name. and the name of Jesus weren't even involved in any of this. In any of this at 325 A.D. It just happened to be another one they're going to come up with. Does your Bible mean anything to you? Does the truth mean anything to you? The Bible says you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. So, in the book of Romans, in the 19th verse, or the 20th verse, I'm going to read this again. Now, understand this here. Here in, it says, but Isaiah is bold, or is very bold, and saith, I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifested unto them that asked not after me. Verse 21 says, but to Israel he saith, all day long have I stretched forth my hand unto a disobedient and a gainsaying people. Now, this is a quotation we just quoted a little while ago. In Isaiah 65 is where he had quoted this. Now, in the 22nd verse, it says, now, excuse me, I say 22nd, it ends at 21. In the 11th chapter of Romans, now remember, you go back and you look at that 10th chapter. He kept going back to the scripture. The scriptures that he went back to used the name of Yahwah, not the name of Jesus. Now, if you think about it, that would be a big contradiction, a big conflict here. Him going back to the scripture and using Yahweh, then all of a sudden coming over to the New Testament, talking to the New Testament assembly, call him Jesus. Totally, totally impossible. Now, if you're a Trinity, you could believe this, because you believe there's three gods. You could believe it. God could have many names. But oneness, you couldn't do it. I said oneness, you could not do it. In the book of Romans 11 and 1, he says, I say then, hath God cast away his people? God forbid. For I am an Israeli. Of course, it says Israelite here. Of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin, or the Hebrew Benjamin. Now, remember, there's a verse that's in the 10th chapter of Romans that we read a few minutes ago, 10:19. He said, I will provoke. Let me read this verse. But I say, did not Israel know? First, Moses saith, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people. And by a foolish nation, I will anger you. Provoke them to jealousy how? If you look and understand that Israel in the Old Testament understood Yahwah, then he's going to provoke them and call a foolish nation that's going to believe Yahwah. You have no harmony with Scripture if you believe it any other way. Jesus will not fit in this. He did not provoke the Gentiles, a foolish nation, with the name of Jesus. But it was with the God that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob served that he would provoke Israel with the same Creator, and Creator by name. And it looks like that our time's come and gone. We come on this same time every week. The time that you listen to us now is the time that we come on every week. And we do appreciate each and every one of you who has taken your time to tune into this program. And we're doing all that we can to try to encourage you to study. It looks like that our time's come and gone. We appreciate you and we love you. Until the next broadcast, shalom.
The mailing address for Yahwah Ministries is 775 McDonald Road, Covington, Georgia, 30014, USA. 775 McDonald Road, Covington, Georgia, 30014, USA. Phone 770-784-0703. 770-784-0703. Visit the website yahwahministries.org. 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 Until next time, we bid you shalom.